But any comments, either generally or from the last session, whichever, just in this sort of waiting period, or other interesting notions?
I'm wondering if you could tell us a bit how this board came to be, Pekko. Like, why did you organize this in a certain way? Or should we wait for Jan to talk about that? Maybe I'm just curious about the intersection of this board and the obok. What did you choose to put in, and what did you choose to leave outside, for example?
Yeah, we could talk about it kind of more, let's say, in an in-depth manner, and then go through the practice when Jan is here. I was kind of waiting for him, but since you don't know how long his lecture takes, so let's just start. So this is a kind of experiment on representing these kind of things, because like I find actually that diagrams are sometimes quite difficult. Like in a way, like the text is kind of too deep and diagrams are too superficial or surfacial in nature, and neither really does the job. Or text is kind of like takes a lot of effort to go through it. So this is an experiment, certainly. But this is kind of trying to give as a kind of working basis is that it's kind of like the whole thing is one scene, which is kind of making this offers. Which was something that was referred to last time, and so there are these roles. There should be a definition of the member rights, probably in another place. Because it's sort of confusing that the roles are here, but they're defined here. But this was kind of like this organizational problematics. But it's the scene of proposing plus making decisions upon those proposals. That's what it is. Inside of it is kind of the offer that can be considered its own scene. Like it has this template of, and it's detailed in this I don't know, central column. Some of the things are defined, but generally I thought that things that would take a long definition are more about conversation and walking through it, because otherwise the whole thing becomes unwieldy. So, but yeah, like if you start from the middle, you can think that the possibility of making an offer proposal is a scene of itself. Okay, there's Jan. Maybe I'll wait for a couple of seconds and continue from there. Hello, Jan. Can you hear us?
Hello, Pekka. So I'm sorry for late. I have a lecture for my students 2, 4 o'clock. So it was for me a little
Yeah,
bit
that's a valid reason
harsh.
to be late. No problem.
Oh,
Yeah.
thank you
Yeah.
very much.
So, are you seeing the screen that is being shared? All right. So this is sort of a little bit of a working ground based on the conversations last session, and trying to give it a little bit of an anchor. It's also slightly experimental because sometimes the concept maps and mind maps are somewhat limited, but so this is an attempt to kind of get more text in. So it's kind of hacking Kanban board to be a mind map, which has a better text options, at least I found. But let's just go through it in practical terms now, and we can think about it. And there is more to fill it. This is more like a starting point. But the idea was this, that okay, if there were these members that had this discourse of essentially offering courses, other academic forms. So there should be a kind of template that puts them in a certain framework, these offers that they make. And that's kind of the center here. So it's kind of its own scene that, like, and here is a proposed kind of areas for the template, like, of course, description. That's very short, that could have much more detail, etc. But then secondly, it has these asks or slots, which are like, let's put this in practical terms. Like if somebody makes an offer for a course, to keep it simple, and there is some description, like the courses would be called this, and it concentrates on this topic and so on and so forth. What the asks are like the practical things that need to be filled in order that that course can become active, that the offer turns into action, essentially. So so it's the idea that, say, a course could have an ask of an economic kind, that it needs a certain amount of funding to function. But it can also have production asks. Better name would be, there could be a better name for this, but the idea is like the course actually, the person who is offering or proposing the course would also need, let's say, a help of a coder to create a website for the course. So that could be a production ask. And then what this template kind of tracks is like, okay, if we have the coder and then we have the economics, then the course can become active. Now, so this is already a kind of different take on normal voting. It does not necessarily replace things like, I think this is a good course, I don't think it's a good course, kind of voting structures. But it kind of creates this sort of additional possibility of even designing the courses or whatever the proposals are, just based on the fact that are they fulfilled? That might be enough, and in some ways it might be even a good form. But you could also say, okay, it needs all the slots fulfilled, and it needs, you know, like a certain amount of voting, and that makes it active. So you can put both conditions. But this having this sort of slots structure allows to, in a way, like have a like 60% fulfilled a course offer, for example. Like it allows for, yes, I have this good idea and I can do the lectures, but I don't have the web coder yet. But this group, these members, they could contain the web coder, and if they are interested, they have the right to commit to that. And then that slot becomes fulfilled, which is of course not possible in normal voting structures. Like you're voting on like a, in a way a ready proposal on. So the center, yes, is this offer template, like essentially right now saying like just description, then defining the slots. There's a little bit of definition to the slots themselves, like for example, that they can ask for a specific fulfillment and they could be defined as open even to anybody outside of the members or the members themselves, or some reason the text is overrunning there, or to they could even be offers to particular members, like, hey, you, are you interested in doing this, or member types if there were such. And then the slots, these are the types of slots. There could be economic asks and production asks, and the outcomes would also be required, which is of course detailing what's the outcome of the said proposal. Like in the case of a course, it would be like running the course, etc. And maybe the course produces a website, that's another outcome, etc. So that's the kind of central part. And of course, like more things could be added, change, etc. Now, the side on the left here, if you're seeing my cursor, this is more showing like kind of practical activity that a member one is actually making the offer here, and then member three as committing to the economic ask, and the member four as committing to also the economic ask. And this was because I thought as a possibility, a structure where members could, like from the allotted funds from the investment, the members could have a share to contribute, like which would be like for every offer you can, when you say yes to the economic ask, you only can give certain amount, and this kind of makes it a question of multiple members to fulfill larger economic asks. So say like the course is asking for 1,000, and each member, using still the common pool, not their own money, they have a right for an offer to commit like 200. So that would mean like 5 members would be needed to get to 1,000. So that's another mechanism, once again, not necessary, it's marked with a question mark there, but to point out that there is this kind of a control possibility as well. And then finally, on the left side, there is like a member five, which is pointed that they commit to a production slot, they become the web coder, for example, which also makes them responsible for that portion of the outcome. So in a way, like the responsibilities are distributed by having the offer, the person who made the offer, they become kind of responsible for running it. It could be a group. But then if somebody says, I will do the website part, well, they become responsible for adding that part in itself. And finally, just quickly through the right column here, which is like essentially detailing what the members can do. In a way, it could be a better place, but now it's here. But the members essentially here have a right of expressing an offer. Recognizing an offer with a question mark, which would be this kind of voting, that you're not committing to anything, but you're saying this is a good offer. So if you want the voting right, then that could be done in this sort of way of recognition. And then committing to an offer. And then there's this mentioned as this possibility of contributions of economic kind would be only shares, or just explained. And then the final kind of question mark here is that there could be possibility to commit as a kind of a relay. Like, let's say there is a person who is connected to a board, and one of the asks is spaces in a university. So a person could commit that they will relay this, they will take it to the board, but of course they cannot commit that the board decides that you will get the space or not. So you could kind of commit to take that ask forward and kind of push it towards its fulfillment, even if you cannot promise it fully yourself, but you can help with it. Anyway, that's the structure. Any questions on that?
This is extremely interesting and thorough. I'm really grateful that you have done this work. I'm wondering if this can point towards, more generally speaking, towards having a clear view of how each OBOC structure, what inputs and what outputs each element has, and how can we sort of like be clear of their modular capacity, for example.
Shortly, yes. I more and more come to the conclusion that way to use diagrams is to make multiple diagrams. So I would make a separate diagram where that just reads the like offer scene just as a title, and then this in itself like is another scene that refers to the offer scene. And like in a diagram you could say like the input from, let's call this the decision scene, this whole thing we're looking at. the input from decision scene would be commitments to the offer itself. And then you could have the members, and from the members you would essentially have like to the offerers the expression of them, but also you could separate like expressed offers and the anyway, like maybe it's not useful to explain the whole diagram in my head because that's probably unclear. But yes, generally I would just like make another more simpler flowchart or mind map, concept map from it on the side. And thanks for commentating my 45-minute struggling with Miro.
Yeah, but I also think that that's in fact really good, and it's immediately understandable kind of for user, in almost like a user interface to a programmable offer or end party offer.
Yeah.
Or offer, and I started to think that I now know that if it was not called an offer but an adventure, so it would be like a or a quest. Well, okay, this is a particular context in this, but it would work like really beautifully, I think, for that too.
Yeah, I agree, and it's also very flexible. Like, I mean, if there is a different, first of all, the name is, I don't really care. Like the whatever label works for the context is better. So it's not a important if it's a called offer or whatever. I think like certain contexts you definitely want to change it to an adventure or whatever. But then secondly, like with the different template and different interactions, you have very different interaction context. But here, like really thinking about this as an interaction context in our terms, a scene makes sense. And thinking about this roles really kind of like players. Oh, I can make a move of expressing an offer, or I could make a move of, oh, there are these offers now, I could commit to here and now. Of course, you can think about it normally, but there is something like extra in terms of thinking of them as game-like scenes and moves.
Yeah, it's very intuitive too, kind of.
Yes, I too like the structure very, very much, and I really find it both beautiful and informative, and it kind of as that sort of like flowchart, I find it very intuitive. You actually want to get involved.
Interesting. Yeah. This is good to know, because like for me it was just a sketch, but apparently I'm much more understandable if I make shitty diagrams. I'm not meaning that diagrams are generally shitty. I just mean that my skills and the result could be better, but like maybe it's a working direction, let's put it that way. I think you're also right in this, that maybe one should look at these kind of directions of diagramming a little bit more with a little bit more effort, because I think the understandability here, but also especially outside, like people who meet this for the first time, whatever, is probably much higher if it's like diagrammed. And the key thing I put aside is that this does not have to now explain everything of the scene, which probably every veteran here knows, because it just would become overcrowded and so on. It's kind of simplified in this sense. Like it's just like, think of this in the way you think of a scene, and think of it as a representation of it is maybe a good rule of thumb.
One other thing kind of about this, like kind of contextual labeling of the offer and the scene. I looked out the meaning kind of from the dictionary and kind of all the meanings for, let's say, quest, it's always like a search for something. And really, as an organization, there is a search going on. You are searching participants, you are searching visiting teachers in this case, or coder, or whatever. I find it very nice that you can kind of, that they are flexible and you can kind of label them.
I think often with structures, like, you come to the point where names start to become labels because the structure becomes more important. As long as the structure does what it does, then it's the labels don't really matter. But I would ask from Jan, since you're kind of on a point of the operator, or kind of like a person like creating a project, particularly, not that we cannot help on that, but like, what's your sense? Do you get the structures what it's getting, or do you have questions or comments?
I think it is very interesting. For me, it is a little bit difficult because I don't have your vocabulary and your gaming vocabulary to the mapping of the project yet. But I am, my learning strategy is listening and then thinking. Yeah, and maybe I have some questions after the meeting. Sorry for that. But for me, it is very interesting is the interaction between role of a offender and member, member three, member four, five, and maybe. Maybe is there some interaction between ask slot and at member one of owner? I don't see the arrow.
Yeah, like there would have been too many lines. This is the kind of problem in this. Like it's drawing certain lines to make an example, but like to run it like in a way, like, because the offer, like, there is actually like a little word here, creates. So in a way, they have expressed the slots, like they have written, for example, this course that I could run this and this kind of course, and description of it, outcomes of it, but also they have defined, like, there is a need for, say, this 1,000 euros worth of economy. That's a slot they would have defined. So that's their main interaction, and they would have defined that it but in order to actually become active, it also needs a web programmer, and this is the task, and that's another slot. Like, it's defined as something that needs to be done, but there's no doer there yet, but that opens it to other members to say, hey, I could do this. And it can also define that this web coder gets X amount of euros from that. Like, that's also a possibility in it. So in a way, they would be the creator of these slots, to put it simply. And maybe the one key thematic I would raise, like, this is kind of opening up and playing around with different interactions around what is conventionally a scene of voting. Like, if you have this making a decision, that you would have this discourse that people could offer things that people could do with money that this organization could, the DAO could have. What kind of other or additional interactions you could have besides just, you know, proposal voting? And for example, the sort of slots open up, there's make a proposal that is partially fulfilled and make it a matter of members to fulfill it. But they can also, you know, decide upon it by voting. And then having this sort of smaller things like relaying, which is like, hey, I can promise to go and talk about this to the board. I cannot commit to, like, your ask is to get a space from university. I cannot fulfill that, but I can relay that, which open up like a wider space of interaction and operation around this kind of decision space. So that's maybe one thing that this tries to kind of highlight.
If I understood correctly, that is really interesting. The ability to kind of have this kind of incomplete offers, and then kind of also one role is to, or there is a role to kind of complete the offer or develop it further or so on. And then I find this is really interesting. Also in terms of like if you would have let's say I have this much resources and then yeah. Then I am simultaneously building five offers developing them and also like thinking that how can I allocate the resources of my group of people or something like
yeah.
that.
Yeah, and it is very flexible, like, you know, like the same format could work if it's somebody's offering, say, having a get together or a party for this DAO or its members. That could be, you know, ask for a DJ and ask for a certain amount of economy and ask for a space or ask for whatever it is asking, a playlist. Like it can follow the same format. It's flexible to very different types of offer-like communication. But Pablo, you had an interesting comment. Can you expand on that?
Yeah, I'm just thinking that I also think this potential of having open spaces in proposals is very interesting because one can focus on what one is sure about and then crowdsource what's what's yet to be defined, right? Like if I have a very, I don't know, I want to propose a course where we read a book, but I have no idea how to take that to a practical level. Maybe someone else can fulfill that.
Yeah.
And this sort of like crowdsourcing of courses in this case can lead to sort of like also getting a sense of the interest of a crowd, right?
Like
in the same process, you're also measuring the interest, the collective interest, which I find very interesting.
Yeah, and it's also like one of the reasons I said here, like that the slot could be defined to open to any. Like it could be like then relate to put it on social media, whatever, like because like, of course, you can limit everything to just members, but if you think it's interesting to offer a certain thing to openly to everyone, you can. And playing around with it, like you said, like in also kind of very small manner that, okay, I have this idea of then reading a certain book, but I would be kind of interested in practices around it. And maybe I'm not even asking for money. It still works in this kind of format. Like it, And you could define a slot that the actual response there is like, because you can say what the slot requires, you could say like, I'm asking with this slot like new ideas for practices. And of course, like potentially also commitment to run them, but also like in addition, like tell the idea of what kind of practice you have. And then those could come to be the place of discourse of actually developing the idea further.
Yeah, I would perhaps ask Jan, since he already has quite a, let's say, grounded example of a course with specific topics, with specific context, with specific kind of embedding within the system, whether you could perhaps relate to some specific examples, like how this offer structure would be functioning, perhaps, just for us to get a like clear glimpse of what kinds of offers are you and slots perhaps are you already thinking of or designing?
So in my sense, what I'm thinking is that the course is kind of like almost like a filled offer that slots have been filled, and it's active. I mean, active at least as content. But it might have slots that are, you know, more from the governance. The slots that it might have is like acceptance, or like Jan can tell the details better, but that's maybe one way to think about it. But I would say like this relates to strongly towards the DAO, because the idea was that the course really works as a Kickstarter for forming this DAO itself that collects funds that come from the NFTs created by the course. But then there was this idea that the DAO would fund other things, essentially, like that. So this is potentially the discourse structure of what those other things could be. That is, the members that come to the DAO would be the members here. And when there is funds, and maybe the investment says, okay, now we have, there could be a rule of say 20% of the, or let's say all the profits, whatever the amount is given, that's the amount that can be made offers to. But then it's up to the other members to commit to these economics asks. Like somebody then says, oh, now that we have these funds, I make this offer for another course. It's this kind of a course. It would need 1,000 euros. And then the other members, one of them says, I like that, but maybe they can only, from their portion, commit to 200 from the fund. But then five members come in, and then that slot is filled from the fund. So the idea is kind of like an engine for like, why, how would the DAO work? How would this new things come about? And how it would be motivating for the members? Because if it's a place that can collect some finance, and if it's a place where you can make this kind of offers and then take part in the decision of them, or take practical actions like committing to their production, these are all, to me, factors that make this space motivated. It's a place that is sensible to join, and it's a place to even develop academic thought and academic actions. So this is really like looking inside the DAO of how do the new things come about. That's the main focus here.
Yeah. Just one.
Thanks.
Sorry.
I just wanted to clarify, because that was a question for Jan, and I'm not sure like about whether actually within this framing, which Pepeko clarified, whether he would see some specific. Yeah, because Jan already has a course idea, right? And it has like pretty specific kind of content and embedding. And so I just was curious, how would it look like? Because now we're speaking still in pretty abstract terms. Not abstract, but I would be curious about how Jan sees how specific offer in that specific context could perhaps look like.
I know that is a direct question for me, Jacob. Thank you for that. But for me, it's very difficult how to identify some offer in my cases, in cases of the course. I think it's there are quite good. Idea, for example, about crowdsourcing courses could be also led to crowdfunding, visiting professor from Pablo. Yeah, I think it's a very good point. And for me, it's from the point of the course, it's very important impact on learning by doing. So, for example, for students, it's, I think, very important, for example, working with some wallets and testnets, as a basic competency for them, so cryptocurrencies, for example, and another is also a function about DAO and how possibly the students can create own DAO, which will be support their organization. For example, some school or something like that. And so when our DAO will be support our course, so it will be a practical experience and practical example how this DAO will be created for students in their organization. I don't know if I answer to your question, Jacob. Maybe yeah, maybe no.
Jakub might have bad internet, or are you there?
Oh, yes.
Yeah. It's sometimes a bit glitchy. But yeah, I guess so, because it was more like to really see whether you can, or we can start relating it to like very specific aspects. So, but yeah, I think, yeah, because it was a bit difficult for me to, let's say, imagine how specific slots might actually look like in the specific situation you are at right now. So yeah. Whether, for example, it would mean, let's say, creating a slot for the actual kind of asking for the funding from the the organization, or whether it would be some student actually takes the task of leading the team or stuff like that, whether trying to kind of bring this to the specifics.
So
to be able to imagine. Yeah.
Uh-huh. Okay, for me is also one question. For me, maybe for yours team I have a question about final task, about the final task from the students. Yeah, and in my other idea is that students will cooperate some creating some NFTs. But seems to me that it's a big task for them, yeah. And I don't know how to cooperate the students and this creating NFT, yeah. It is for me, for example, interesting question.
So, if one walks through it, how to conceive these kind of offers. I think you can start very simply, that. Let's say you have an idea of a course, and I know that your course is kind of in a different position because it's more like a Kickstarter, and this is thinking about if it wants to kickstart a DAO, how does the DAO work? But nevertheless, we can use it as a kind of basis. But the simple task is to list. First of all, a description can be really even a normal description. What is about to be made, or what is the task taken? But then one can ask oneself, what is missing? In your course, it might be a specific acceptance. Then there is a question which is a source that can give this what is missing? In my earlier examples, for example, a website coder, it could be anyone, but then you have a definition of this is the task, and then people can evaluate whether they can fulfill that task, and then they can become a person who can provide that. But it can also be if it's in your case, a certain acceptance in a governance, then who can provide that is, say the board or structure like this. I don't know the details of that too well, but it can also be some person might offer to relate that task or give it partially, that say I can speak for it in, I'm a member of the board, I can speak for it in the board, and that could be a way of not fulfilling the slot, but essentially taking it forward. But there can be other things missing, like you said, the NFTs. Then, what could be missing as a slot is, like NFT production, programming, etc., like actually providing the framework. So that's a slot then. And who can provide that? Maybe that's an open offer to everybody, that if somebody knows a person who could do this or persons, then take it forward. And so in a way, like it creates this logic of what's there and what's missing, what's the definition of what's missing, and then who can provide that. And that, so it, like underneath that, there is a very bread and butter logic. And once you go through those questions, you can see, okay, something is missing, it's a slot. Who can provide that? That's a definition for the slot as well. Like, who is it then ask for? And go from there.
Just a few comments from a kind of one kind of teacher's eyes from that side of things, from my own perspective. Like, I'm, there is a difference kind of in whether you kind of decide that, okay, I will now in a kind of conventional way, I will be designing my own course, and then I will be like having that course, and kind of I will be knowing all the components that I need to have in my course and so on. But then again, the other possibility is like to kind of to start creating the course from scratch in a collaboration or collaborative way, and as a collaboration actually, and kind of so in order to think like from not like from up to bottom, so that but more like bottom to up in this case. And one kind of idea or question, okay, now we have this like very material things at the moment, but what if we only like leave the money part there, because we always need some resources in order to carry something out in the kind of university world. But then again, what if we take the learning objectives that we want to achieve? This kind of I'm thinking about, let's say, in Paris Ecole 42, or in Finland this place called Hive, which is part of the same structure. So they actually the idea is that they have these like competence charts. So what you need to learn, and then you list kind of these bullets, what I need to learn, and then then what if that plus the money would be the offer, and then someone comes in and says that, hey, I can offer or contribute something to, let's say, teaching about collaborative writing of an essay, for instance, okay, or the practice of writing that, and so on. So then that kind of slot becomes like a field, and so on. And in this case, you wouldn't have to know. Or you wouldn't have to create this sort of like only this, like, okay, we know that we need someone who does exactly this. We only want someone who is able to do it in their own way and expertise or something like that.
So, yeah, like, sorry, I'm struggling because I was thinking of adding your ideas to the slots, but maybe later. So. Like, I think in a way, like precisely this is the kind of flexibility in the structure. You could have an offer that is open to other offers. Like, you can make offers to the offer, like, hey, I could do this. And you can also make an offer that has, you know, like the what you need to learn as types of slots in themselves, just like you said. But it could also have as well, like an ask, particular ask for a web designer. And that has a different time frame, right? That might be, the web designer might be needed before everything begins, whereas the time for the learning would be when the course finishes or whatever it is. Like it's like, I think you're already opening up that there is this expressibility in this kind of format, which is that it plays with this, like the directions you described, the kind of like you can start the course by making everything yourself or start from scratch. This is exactly a kind of spectrum in between. Like you can start from an idea, define certain things, and you can be an individual or a group. But you can also have things that are undefined, and you can be open to new ideas or not. Like it's really up to you and how you define it. So in a way, like it's providing a form, expressive form to the in-between spectrum of starting from scratch and doing everything by yourself.
One question would be, I'm thinking the kind of for that, if the proposals in the offer can be like so varied, and the what do you basically your ask can be also so varied, it's some standardization or kind of some templating there. Like for instance, if you think of the crowdfunding templates, there are very few moving parts which actually makes the matching possible. Yeah. If they're like too baroque, they are never going to move. That's the kind of the, that's one thing. And then the other one is that, if you remember, there's one very famous example of the American Information Exchange. I don't know if others know it, but me and Pekka have been studying it. It's the original smart contracting platform from the 1990, which was a very interesting experiment. And they we know the authors and or the founders, and what they found out, it was really, really important of how kind of what they understood then, that how it's important to kind of to build the way to the actual acceptance or the matching of the offer. So you need to have like this dialogue going on, kind of where people can discuss and kind of negotiate support, like getting to the actual acceptance. Yeah. And if it's missing there, then they kind of had to, because nothing was moving in their offer market, so they had to like build that support structure there, and then it became like more fluid.
Yeah,
which makes total sense to me.
Yeah, it makes like it's kind of the possibility there. Like I added the counter offer, just like I didn't want to go too deeply in, because it's always possible that one way to answer an offer is to make a modification to it and offer it. And if the original offer accepts that, then that's the functioning offer.
On other example, kind of, so I'm deep into the NFTs and I love them. And I'm collecting them, and so in OpenSea, for instance, so they have this, people are bidding to buy some of my NFTs that I have, and just only very recently, like 3 weeks ago, they added their a counter offer. So now I can basically make a counter offer to somebody who's bidding on some of my things, to my NFTs, so that I can say, hey, no, it's 5.5 ether more, and then I'll sell it to you. So they added that, which made it much more like a communicative, much more better medium already. But what is missing still there is that I would like this chat possibility. Mm-hmm. I'm sure that it's going to come, but it's necessary that I would like to kind of message a little bit more to the she who is making an offer to me. I would like to kind of ask, like, why do you want? Are you a good home for this one? You know, something like this.
Yeah, definitely. Like, I can see this kind of format, even when it's functioning on Discord, like in a way, like each offer is its own topic, and like for the idea that the, like underneath it or along it is a chat, because you kind of, this kind of even intensifies the need of being able to talk about it, being able to communicate it on it, like it's but like this kind of functionality is, in a way, like I think it's an oversight because it's kind of easy to implement. I mean, there's gazillion chat engines, but it's a big benefit. I agree with you. And on the point that you said, like if it's like too much is possible, the one thing, like of course, I'm interested in painting all these possibilities to kind of express the kind of flexibility of the format. But why there is a word template here for the offer is that you can also completely curtail it. Like you can make, like in this, say, a DAO, you can make these kind of offers which only have, can have asks for economy or whatever it is. Like that the fact that it's a template for the offer can make it free, more constrained, or whatever in between. Like what can be actually in the offer in itself. Like
So what did you mean by the DAO? What is the, what's the DAO here?
So this relates to Jan,
the context. Jan's
project. But the idea is...
I'm saying that each offer is basically a little DAO.
Yeah, here. You can think of...
It's a programmable...
Yes.
DAO.
I'm with you on there. Like, but in terms of this, like, essentially, you can think of this idea towards like an, in a way, like a DAO that can be funded by a course, but then becomes source of funding for other things that
it's like a DAO, that, DAO. Yeah. DAOs. Yeah.
Yeah. So, but I can explain you the details also later. Like you.
And I've checked it beforehand, so yeah. I think I understand.
Yeah, but the the key of the templating is like it gets just as baroque as you allow it to get, or just as little baroque as the offer is templated to. But let me ask in general, like especially Jan, like or anybody else or so, but like what would you see as the next steps? Like there is of course the question of getting things going, but like I think for that, like having the actual kind of design, at least in a draft level, like how could the DAO you're imagining work, like is a key thing. But like how are you thinking moving forward, practically speaking, with the idea you have?
Seems to me that I need more create some idea about maybe more clarified parts of the project, and then focus on one of the parts, for example, DAO. Create more details about the DAO, and then move to another part, and create more deeper focus on another part. And maybe it's a good next step for me, and so maybe more clarify to the parts. The project, especially if one of the part is DAO, another is, for example, course, or another is saving funds, crypto funds, maybe another is interaction. This is a possible next step. But it is a very interesting discussion for me. Yeah, I am in a little time pressure because I'm so sorry, but I have to go home to my
yeah.
wife, and I have a long way home to home. So I'm so sorry for that. Yeah, maybe Jacob can create some notes about your discussion after. And I
read this. Yeah, that's okay. Jakub mentioned that you can only be for an hour, so that's I knew beforehand. This is also why to have the kind of fast start.
Yes. So thank you very much for your interesting about the project. It is very important for me, and I feel a little bit nervous about that I can answer your questions. Sometimes, yeah, but it's only for me starting in thinking in this framework. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and maybe as a final comment, like the really thinking of like the DAO that is created in its own terms, like that because the reasons that motivate people to the course, and then reasons to that motivate this continuance of that economy are different. So this is maybe now more looking at the reasons for to motivate the DAO, because like you have a lot of the reasons of why the course would be motivated since you're creating it. Of course, one can visit those, but that's probably a more mapped ground. But the DAO needs its own reasons, and why? Because you had the idea that even other academic members could join. This is kind of trying to figure out the reasons why would they join in the first place, like, and so on. Like, so having some picture of that is important.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you. Maybe my next steps is also discussion with our authority in our Faculty of Education. I mean, head of the Faculty of Education, yeah, because for them it's little bit quite scary some DAO and cryptocurrencies, yeah, because in their traditional world it is something new and something what is very dangerous for them, yeah. So I think it's very important focus to create strong relationship with head of Faculty of Education and create understanding about the processes in DAO and in crypto saving funds, for example. Yeah, I think it is very important. Mm. Creating some trust. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Agreed. Mm. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
So bye. Bye.
Bye. So, Jakub is back online also, it seems. But any comments from anybody, like in terms of, like, as we are kind of maybe concluding this part of our session, like, what kind of things are still in your mind?
I am mostly thinking of how could we make these elements, the OBOK elements or other elements, into a more modular, and how, like I wrote in the chat, the input modifiers output, maybe as a format to understand what is the possibility of each element, and maybe that would be a way in which we can plug it into existing organizations, create new organizations from scratch, and have a more, how would you say, actionable approach to the elements.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe that could be helpful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the key. I think that it needs to be like very inviting and actionable and easy to and do. Otherwise, it's because we've kind of tried. This is Pekka, I think the best model I've seen so far. I gotta say, it's I really like it because we've tried. And if you get the things wrong, then just people are like said no, and nothing is moving. It's really important to get those that like a inviting and kind of attracting elements right there.
Yeah,
of course, that's just a skeleton and the base structure, which is great, but yeah.
But yeah, agreed. Like it's a lot of it is about communication and communication yeah. material. And I also agree with you, Pablo, on the like I can see that, you know, this is almost like a bubble, which is the scene of, let's call it decision or whatever it's called. But then it's in a graph just as a bubble. And then it takes inputs from the members. Their members have rights that they can do, and it takes their offers, it takes their commitments, it produces something, and it also takes potentially finance. So it's kind of like the engine that decides whether, say, the finance goes in. But then an output from there is a course, and you can definitely draw this sort of inputs and outputs, where this is like one bubble that produces inputs and outputs, therefore a scene, like and like, but it's better if it's like a different diagram, simplifying just that issue. Like putting it here probably creates this once again this sort of too much chaos or too much stuff simply kind of a situation, and that people lose their understanding again. Which is often what I find with like diagrams, that when they grow too big, you know, like people just lose the sense of it, like tracing of it. They just roam around and don't really get it. So like I think it's like definitely creating these inputs and outputs. And this is also the direction of the last playtest we did with the XORG, which had this idea that if new scenes like doors are created, it's about inputs and outputs, like what goes in from there. And I think that kind of structure is very useful around these bubbles that these interactions form.
I really like that like comment that there is a kind of or that each of these scenes or offers are like their own small DAO. In a sense, kind of, it brings an idea of a kind of some sort of like a space role playing game simulator, something like that. Okay, we have this like we have these local star systems and or some planetary systems, and then we have like these stellar systems, and then we have this like galaxies, and we have this like the whole system and universe and universes and so on. But in a sense that that by moving into this scene or offer or so, I'm able to access that particular part of the kind of location of the world or something similar. And one other thing, I really would like to try out like with a role playing, I mean traditional role table role playing gang, like just to try it out, that like how could you and I mean these long campaigns where you play, you have been playing like 5 years, 10 years, so on, you own certain amount of like money yourself, and your group owns a certain amount of money, and okay, we are interested in the money that you can invest in this group, and then you come in and make the decisions. Okay, do we want to build this castle here, or do we want to, let's say, hire four more rogues or something like that? What are we going to do? And it's really important, because you need the persistence. You need to keep track every dime, even if you have billions. It's just for the kind of that you can, it helps you kind of in the immersion and persistence and so on. So I would be really interested in kind of this sort of things as well.
Yeah, I think it's in a way like completely possible. Like they are actually, these role-playing games are much more modular friendly than their expression is. Like if you actually kind of take away the expression and look at the structures, there's a lot of like potential modularity in there. Like it's kind of has been present as traces in some of the games that we have been playing. And also this concept of the scene, like it owns a lot to the last 15 years about of development around the concept of the scene itself in role-playing, which is precisely actually thinking of a scene as a modular interaction. And there's a lot of good thinking on that in itself. Once again, whatever one calls it doesn't have to be a scene, but that thinking is important. But also like generally the approach that we have, like it's actually quite modular friendly. Like let's say it like this, like in a way, like a role as a type, like a member, as you can think of it as a bubble itself. To that bubble, you pull like say Mikael and Pablo, which are their own bubbles, because they could have another role. But then that role of a member goes to this particular interaction or a particular, like a cluster of interactions, which are all connected, which forms an organization. But you, Mikael, have another role, and then that goes to another, gives you rights to another cluster of interactions, another organization. So, like it's really just like drawing the lines, like it's already there, this potential of high modularity in and of itself. So yeah, like I think that direction is certainly has a lot of potential.
Yeah, I really like it also. And as Pablo mentioned, the kind of fractality of the organization organism. So mm-hmm. I was thinking that this like realization that we get.
Oh no.
Oh,
nice image.
We need the point. Like let's see if he comes back, because he was just getting to the meat.
Cliffhanger,
yes.
Some exercise spreads.
Yeah.
And also what came to my mind was that like the viable systems model, where they are also like working with the concept of nesting. And I was kind of wondering whether at some point it might be a useful exercise to like relate it to the VSM in terms of that they are also like working with different kinds of inputs, outputs, and feedback loops, right?
Yeah.
And kind of looking for viability of those subsystems. So perhaps that could be also an interesting event.
We got the last part of your point, but your beginning was lost, like maybe 25 seconds from. So can you repeat the beginning of your point, Jakub?
Yeah. The last word was fractal.
So yeah, I was saying that I really like the open organization. They practice the thinking and practice the thinking in those terms, like making the thinking fluent in seeing those X's or like in the nested ways, and then I'm switching to the VM, right? But that was already
We could generally hear you. I stopped screen sharing that you could come through, so but I do think like this sort of fractalic thinking, there are actually so if we go back some weeks and point to the saving and capture and the thematics around this sort of like potential realms, which is kind of beyond the potential worlds like model, it actually has a high recursive quality. And maybe at some point I started writing it up actually. It's actually more recursive than common thinking of what the fractalic is. Because like, to make a practical example, like we had this idea of like, say there is this world that there is this particular event, this scenario, and you can enter that event with people and run through the scenario itself, and then you can make a report or telling of what happened. And somebody might enter that place where the scenario was, you know, with your effects included, or they might enter the scenario from the beginning, like the same point where you started. So you have this sort of potential layering as well. And I think that structure in itself is actually something that is almost needed to be built into an argument, because it kind of like takes this sort of recursive space and blows it up to 11 or whatever fancy term you want to use. But I do think we kind of touched upon it already. Like it's summarizable, I think. And that might be a good task for some session. But yeah, like as a, if there are no other comments on this, the one thing I could say as another point, which was sort of inspired by Jakub, partly because he was starting his currency, now that he's in the currency group, now that he's in the game design school. I took some of my old notes of what I call token behaviors. And unless somebody minds the jump, I could just give a short introduction to that as a whole model from elsewhere. So because I actually, finding the old notes that I had, like, I ended up writing for a couple of days, over a couple of days, like a much more comprehensive take on this. And I know it's another big topic, but I'll just like take this as simply an introduction. Let's not dive in this, but it's something that if somebody's interested, we might work on. So it's called behaviors, or it could be called token behavioral mapping, because it's about like certain kind of operations and actions you could have in tokens, but it's also modular and combinable. So the behaviors are meant to be like, okay, there's this behavior, like this token can or cannot be burned, and this token can be transacted or not. If you combine the non-transaction, are you leaving, Akseli?
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, I gotta go. I have the other meeting coming, and I need to prepare it a little bit. But yeah, otherwise, hey,
yeah,
it's really nice.
Yeah, actually,
great,
I might
really
be
good work.
I might be only partially present, but I'll come anyway. All right,
fine. But it's gonna be good. By the way, I talked with Jorge about the external demo session, where I think we should invite everybody here also, and he's okay with it. Let's do it in 2 weeks or something.
Yeah. All right. Okay.
Okay. Hey.
Later.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Yeah. So just quickly, like, so like this sort of modularity and combinability are key values. Secondly, it's about variety in this model, because it's trying to map behaviors that are not just in the conventional space of tokens, but behaviors that haven't yet been maybe thought of. But I'll just quickly give you a sense of it. Like there are some technical parts. Like I can say that there are there's one other person, Theodore Wilson, who worked on some of these models, and some of the technical parts are from him. Like there are tokens that are simply signals. They reference a null void object, if you think of it programmably, and all the capacities, which are the behaviors here, would be afforded. It can be a value structure, and essentially that means that it has a read-only interface. Or it can be a control reference. I know I should be going faster because the key point here is then what kind of behaviors these different types could have. Like, of course, almost all tokens are class identifiable. Like, this is also slightly connected to object oriented. Like, they are a certain class, like a Bitcoin or whatever. Like, one could potentially think of a classless one, but that would still have its own class. But then separately from there, you can think of a subclass identity. So this is a case that is actually present in card suites, like playing cards, like spades is a subclass, or can be thought of as a subclass. So what can you do if the token does not just have a class, but it has a subclass? Can they be symmetric or asymmetric and things like this? Then, of course, you have an individually identifiable token, which is like a token that has an, every token has an identity. But then that opens up to a thought that you could have that individual tokens could have relations or form relations using the behaviors listed below. And this forms a kind of like subclass from the bottom up that if a token decides to form a relation, and it can with another token, they kind of form their own family in a way, which is kind of like a not subclass set from the top down, but from bottom up. But anyway, yeah, like it goes very deep. Like you have like, is the token quantifiable or not? You have also this behavior, like if the token either is or isn't, if you have the token or not, that's not a quantifiable token. Like, is it fractionable? Is it actually locatable? That like, is there a way to of record to locate it? Is it summable? Like, can it be actually pooled into a sum? And because I can actually imagine a board game that does not allow it. Like, you can get one pool that is 5 and one pool that is 3, but you cannot make it into an 8. Like, the pools are what they are. This is where we're getting to the ground that these are really kind of exotic token behaviors. It's a long list, so I'll just pick a couple of others. I can give you the document later. There can be tokens that are combinable. That is that they combine to another functionality. Like 10 tokens can be combined and that creates a whole another thing. And then you can think, are they actually dividable or not? Like, can you take this whole other thing and break it back to 10 tokens or not? And then there are things like horrible terms like sideable, which is means that the token has n sides, like 2 sides. And that means a logic where you have the token, you can either use one side or the other side, but you have to choose which. And this is used in actually many card games quite successfully, where you know, one side of a card is the operation. If you turn it around, it's a value. Like, this card can be used as this move, but it can also be used as 3 value in itself. And this mechanism in board game has proven itself very flexible. Verifiable, clonable, holdable, which is kind of ownership, or what we think of as ownership, that it can be held. And once again, one can imagine a token that is the only way you can operate it is to do a particular operation. It kind of exists in some organization, but you cannot hold it. You can operate upon it, but then you're hold on it is let go after immediately after the operation. Fungible, etc. And then there is like different takes on minting and issuance. Like, is it contextual? Like, can it only happen in a certain context, like usually? Or can actually other contexts that can issue token be generated? Is it persistent or periodical? Does it like the issuance continue, or is it like exhausted? Is there a governance on the issuance or not? Like, or a logic, like conditional logic saying under these conditions we issue more. There's transactable, which is the token movable or not, but there can be transportable, which is a token that can move to an external context versus a token that only changes the reference from this identity to that identity, but actually remains in the same context. Like ESC20 is actually this, like it cannot be transported. Persistence, which is like, is there, for example, a particular contract that can burn the token, destroy it essentially? And then there's a lot of like this variety comment mean are meant to underlie what kind of areas bring the variety to the token, like token burns in a specific context, that's a lot of design space in itself, like what context and for what reasons and so on, or under specific conditions. Consumable is a bit wacky, but it's used in board games. I think I can remember one, which is like, whenever you use your token, it's not actually used. And a board game example is, in some games you earn token-like things, like say you have now 5. But when you use it for buy operation, you still have 5. But the only point is you can only buy up to 5. If you get another token, you might have 6. And now you can use it to buy operations up to 6, but as many as possible. It's a wacky operation, but it has its uses. Yeah. But there's a lot like revocable, permutable, enactable, etc. And then here, actually, let's put it in the editing form because it's clearer. There are a couple of examples of like common forms in a kind of instruction manual. Like what we think of as a coin is generally used as usually a pattern of fungible and transactable, and probably some others, but these are like key values to recognize it. Whereas a point commonly used as fungible but non-transactable. And so it goes. There could be a lot of these things. And as a final point, which really blows this thing to stratosphere or how many possibilities, I came up with this idea of a token frame, which is the immediate operational context of a token. So let's say, I'll take a practical example, a hand or a deck. Like if you have a token but really operates in a deck and then it operates in a hand, well, that is different from a token that goes into a slider, which is this kind of thing that whenever a new thing appears, it slides all the other things forward. And it can also operate in like a constellation where there's this pattern that says like, you need one blue token here and one red token here and one green token here. And when all of those are there, it activates a combination in a certain sort. And so that's another kind of a frame for it. And in a way, wallet is a frame in itself, like the traditional one. And of course, like referring to the earlier case, offer in a way can be thought of as a token frame as well. So like once you start combining the behaviors and then thinking of like different frames to put the tokens that are combined from these behaviors, like it's like whatever gazillion number of different variants you get from here. So this is just something I wanted to show you as kind of on the side, very much colored by games, but also like something that is a structure that has some interesting possibilities. Whether we find it useful or not, that's another question. But yeah, that's one I wanted to show you as this kind of thing exists.
I will play my tokens, put my tokens on asking that we can at some point have a session on this, because I find this would really be kind of something that would be sparking imagination and also knowledge about these things. So I would be very, very up to having a session on these.
Sounds good. What about you, Pablo? I saw your hand signs, but
yes, that was an approval of Mikhail's comments. But yeah, I actually think there's a lot of intersection with the current C design philosophy.
Yes.
In yeah. the holochain space that I know Jakob is very fond of and that I've also studied. And it's just like, it would be really interesting to do this mapping and see the intersections because I believe there's a lot of them. For example, the signaling sounds to me pretty much as the idea of the nominal currencies.
Yeah.
Like that you Close. Cannot transact, for example. Yeah, like reputation yeah. you cannot transact, but it signals a certain proficiency or trust in a certain community. So yeah, I really think this is very productive. Mm. And yeah, sort of like doing this mapping would sort of allow us to see both lacking things in both frameworks or things that make them more powerful. Like, I don't know, I just find it really productive.
Yeah.
It's amazing and very thorough. I'm really happy you shared this.
Yeah, and it's I agree. Like, actually, this was kind of inspired by the currency because there was this one session Jakob invited me, and then kind of I soft promised that, oh, I have this document, I should like bring it in. And then, of course, I ended up working on it, which was good because it's now much more complete, or it's never complete, but like much more comprehensive. But like you pointed out, this signaling, like, of course, I know the things here and the system, I can immediately see, whoa, there is like several ways to do that. Like which behaviors you want, like, oh, I can make it non-transactable, but even have it like a behave like otherwise be a normal token. Like, or you could make a token that is transactable, not within a context, but on, but it is transactable into external context. Like, it's weird, but like when I was thinking of these games, often when I found a weird form, I could think like, well, there is this mechanism in the games itself, like the two-sided. It sounds weird for people. But then I look at all these card games that solved like how to have an economy and operations in an economic package. Well, you made two-sided cards, and like it's one of these sort of mechanisms that people really like. It's like some of these things haven't entered the token space, but have already proven their kind of mechanical usefulness for right cases. So yeah, like I think it would be interesting to go through that and then think of like these forms and what could come out of there. And potentially interesting thing to put as a basis of release of some kind. Because it hasn't really been released. Like the original one was like 2-3 years old, and it's been sitting on my computer. And yeah, so it would be useful to bring it out.
Hey, I need to leave. Thank you so much for this. We need some daylight to do some work yeah. in the home. So
yeah, yeah. I think yeah, we're nearing the end anyway. So
but, hey, good weekend. Thank you.
Thanks. Pablo,
tell me.
Practical, actually, I'll stop the recording.